Hello, everyone, and welcome to this edition of the Stogie Geeks Show. I'm your host, Paul Asadorian, joined by the wonderful cast and crew here at the Stogie Geeks in Studio B, a.k.a. the Man Cave. I actually got an email from an electronics dealer that said, soup up your man cave, and it was like TVs and HDMI cables and all kinds of fun stuff. And I was like, ooh, I have one of those. So Mark Jr. is here with us. Welcome, Mark.
Thanks for having me.
Good to have you here. And Ben is, of course, here with us as well.
Hello.
Say hello.
How's it going?
Yes. So that rounds out the crew. I'm just going to tell the world that we're broadcasting. So, Mark Jr., why don't you start us off with the Stogie of the Week. Tell us what it is and a little bit about it. I'll chime in, too. Just give me a moment.
Okay. So, the Stogie of the Week is a EPC Carrillo core line natural Ecantos. It's a Robusto. It's 5x50. And I believe, Paul, you said that these have close to 2 years of age on them now?
Yeah, so I bought them, I think, March. Was it March 2011 or 2010? I'm not sure. I have to go back. I can go back and look. I can tell you for sure.
Okay. So
they've got some age. They're
kind of old.
They've
got some age on them. They're really, really delicious. And
at least
a funny story
a year
is
and a half.
Paul actually has a sign. Personalized sign box from Ernesto.
Yeah, I can hold that up for the camera. I've talked about these on the show before, but we've never actually done them for the show. But Ernesto was kind enough to sign the box for me, which is always kind of a nice thing to have in your humidor. And I got the opportunity to meet him. He's a super nice guy. And I bought a box and I said, here, please sign it. And he's so nice. It was a great experience. It was St. Patrick's Day. Probably a year and a half ago.
It's a Nicaraguan cigar with a Dominican and Nicaraguan filler, Nicaraguan binder, and an Ecuadorian Sumatra wrapper. So, as many of you know out there, the EPCs are some of our favorites and hopefully some of yours.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm staring at the picture now that I put on. So it was March 19th, 2011. Mm. Which would be St. Patrick's Day.
And you said that they already had some age on them.
They were probably already sitting in the store for an unknown period of time.
Things
right?
Like
they
this weren't end up sitting there.
Yeah, exactly. So that's why I think the cellophane's a little yeah, because my guess is they're probably pushing closer to 2 years of age on them because they were in the shop for a little while.
So. They taste like they would be. So
yeah. And you read off the binder and the filler. It's a fabulous blend. So I smoked one on St. Patrick's Day of this year, right? So a year from the day that I bought them. And I thought they were very, very good. They still got a good amount of strength left in them. You think Ecuadorian wrapper. You think Ecuadorian. It's not a Connecticut, though. That's a regular Ecuadorian wrapper. That doesn't look like a Connecticut to me.
No, it's an Ecuadorian Sumatra wrapper.
Sumatra,
not an Ecuadorian seed. They're not a Connecticut seed Ecuadorian wrapper.
Gotcha,
so.
Gotcha. Yeah. So, I mean, it's got a little more kick to it than you would think being, an EP corn. They're not, I mean, people usually say, medium full maybe.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
And it's got some kick to it. It's nice.
It's got a little pepper, a little spice. Big fan of the naturals.
I almost get like a, I don't want to say it's orange peels, but it's a, almost a fruity kind of essence to it. I don't think it's any particular kind of fruit, but it's got kind of that really nice, sweet kind of fruity flavor.
It's citrusy, particular to me.
Citrusy, I would call it in the citrus more.
Yeah.
If it was a woody flavor, it would be like a wood that has been used to store fruit. You know, that's kind of
like
the
Grand Marnier cask or something like that.
Yeah. I'm really a big fan of these.
Oh, I'm yeah.
I haven't smoked one in a while, so I pulled out the box and I said, "Well, in the absence of Tim, who normally handles our Stogies of the Week, that means that since we're all here, I just get to go in my humidor and pick random stuff." So I didn't have a lot of time, so I chose what I knew I had a lot of, rather than go picking through singles and hope I had three of them. You know, so that's what I picked. There is another career that I want to do on the show, which is the Atlantic 15th anniversary. Which is sitting behind me as well. So, and that one that I talked about last week is really, really good. So, let's see. Let's move on to our Stogies of the Week. and then we'll kick off a segment later in the show on how to do a Coolidor. So I did another Davidoff White edition, and this is the 2012 release. Equally as good as the first. I mean, these are box worthy. These are really expensive. $22 a cigar. However, it hits you with a blast of what you think is going to be like that grass fest experience in the beginning. Like, first few puffs. It starts to settle down very, very quickly, almost like a Millennium blend. And just has a nice wood and earth profile. Very smooth. Fantastic smoke. These are going to age really well, too.
Good.
It's one of those Davidoffs that isn't a grass. This is the one we tend to look for, right? Mm. The ones that have too much grass flavor, we're like, it's got too much grass. The ones that don't, we're like, yeah, the ones that don't may have a touch of it, which is fine, but pick up some other nice flavors. So.
Yeah, it's impossible to get away from it entirely.
Yeah, yeah.
With the Davidoff name, but yeah, no.
And you haven't had this white edition yet, have you?
I have not, no.
They're at the other local shop. For $22 a piece, if you want to splurge, so I had some budget, some slush fund budget that I chose to go buy stuff like that. So specifically, so we could talk about them on the show.
Yeah, of course.
I think at $22, I mean, I'm saying for me, it's box worthy. I would pay. I could see myself if I really wanted to splurge, paying $220 for a box of 10. Although you think about what that $220 buys in other cigars, and you tend to be a little gun shy on them, these are really special. I think for most people, they're probably going to be a try one, special occasion kind of cigar.
That's fair. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, fair enough. I'll go to my first one then. I smoked a Julius Caesar, Diamond Crown Julius Caesar Perfecto, not the one that's in the Charitable Foundation dual coffin that came out. This was an event-only cigar, so it's hard for me to find all the stats on it in mm-hmm. terms of size.
Yeah, I saw it. I was like, what is that?
Yeah, it looks exactly the same shape as the Colorado Claro Short Perfectos that Paul and I both love tremendously.
Oh, well, then those come from the same company, essentially, right?
No.
No? No. I'm sorry. Julius Caesar is J.C. Newman.
Correct.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. It's a Central American filler and binder. And Havana seed Ecuadorian wrapper.
Well, you know why I say that is because at Casa Fuente, you can buy Julius Caesar.
Well, they're owned by Fuente.
Yeah.
So
not Davidoff by Fuente.
Davidoff is owned by Fuente.
No. Diamond Crown is.
Diamond Crown is. Yeah, yeah. I gotcha.
Yeah. It's a Diamond Crown Julius
Caesar. It's a Diamond Crown Julius Caesar.
Yep, exactly. Gotcha. It was a
tricky. That's real tricky.
Yeah, Diamond Crown. I'm off tonight, just to let everyone know.
We've all been suffering from colds this week.
I'm a little out of sorts today. So
my list of cigars of the week is kind of short. I know mine is too. Yeah. But this was a really, in my opinion, the best Vitola I've smoked of that blend so far. It was really concentrated and had that dynamic flavor change up that you would expect from a Perfecto.
Right.
That the Robusto and the Bellicosos that I've had before did not have, right? So it was very similar flavors. It had the, that kind of toasty, nutty type flavor to it. It had a little bit of spice. It was a really, really awesome smoke. I would say box worthy, but considering it's an event only cigar, I'm going to make up a rating on the spot here. Do what you can to find one.
Yeah. Some of the cigars we talk about, not a lot, but some are going to be in that category.
Yeah. Do what you can to find one.
Mm. It was unique looking to see that shaped cigar with the Julius Caesar band. I was like, wow, never seen that size.
I actually
before.
Went into a really famous shop. I don't want to give them I don't want to give them away because I know it's limited. But
it's like when you watch TV and the shirt the person's wearing is blurred out.
But you know what's behind it.
Yeah, but you know what's behind it. Yeah.
Yeah. Super nice guys. I pulled my normal question. What do you got? That's not out here type thing, mm-hmm. you know? And these surfaced, so I was very pleased to try one.
Well, along the lines of cigars, although these have become more available lately.
Yes.
Yeah, speaking of.
The My Father Special S. I do link to 50% Flat Tire because they've got all of the background and history, if you're interested in that kind of thing, around this cigar. This was typically only handed out at events. It is a 5x50 Robusto, released in February of 2011. It sports an Ecuadorian Habano Rosado wrapper, a Nicaraguan binder and filler. Of course, comes from Nicaragua in the My Father Cigars factory. And these are box-worthy. If I could buy a whole box of these, I think I would. It's got this nice, I want to say it was a nuttiness. It's got this kind of unique flavor that presents itself to it.
It does not have the typical Don Pepin Garcia pepper blast.
There's no spice. There's a little bit of spice up front, but there's not the pepper. It does not have. I did not notice any pepper in it.
Yeah. which I found to be a nice changeup. I am a fan of his blends, so I don't mind the pepper blast. But it was a nice changeup. I agree with your assessment. I also smoked one of these this week.
Yeah.
It was. I agree with your assessment. It's a really, really tremendously awesome smoke. Luckily enough, you can find them on retail online retailers now in three packs. Yeah,
really,
in three packs for $30.
That's not. I wouldn't chase for them. I've had them too. They were at the first annual pig roast. I remember grabbing a couple because
they were floating around for a little while.
I liked them. Yeah, I've seen it with a different band.
Those are different.
Yeah, that's
there is actually. So we could talk about that for a minute.
Now we know.
There's actually three.
Yeah.
Special limited edition Robustos that they've made so far.
Okay.
The first one was the El Centurion Robusto, which I believe came out in 2009.
Which
it's in the
March.
It's
and
in
I,
the flat we did tire
some t- we did yeah. some training before the show for because this has been one of my white whales. So this would be the El Centurion.
Yep.
Robusto.
So that is the cigar that the other two are based off of. So the and then there's the special S, which this came from, and then there's a special S white, which I also was able to score a couple of recently.
Yeah, and you gave me one of those two, and I don't have it with
it
me,
inside,
but it's
yeah.
inside.
And either just the, like it's like the next edition of the special cigar that you get.
Yeah, it's iterations of their event cigar, essentially, is what it's come down to, yeah.
Well, this review, 50% flat tired, says what it is. He does talk about what the differences are.
So, yeah, there.
Yeah, so there you can see up there on the screen. If you're watching the video, it's hard to see.
Can you see it through mine?
So there's also a special S with a totally different blend, which comes in a white three-pack cardboard box. Remember, this cigar is for... This release are not event cigars, but were sent out in limited quantities to some of the largest My Father accounts to sell separately.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
So there you go.
So, yeah.
But the S and the Centurion were event cigars.
Were event-only cigars. Yeah. Yeah. So you might find some of those kicking around left over from an event. So, or get to a My Father Cigars event and ask around for those.
Yeah.
Would be the strategy to get
you
them, right?
You can see them on some of the larger retailers. For a while, this was the only way you'd see them, is if you bought a box of certain My Father products, it would come with a throw-in of the three-pack.
I bought 2 3-packs.
I got 2 3-packs of the white.
And I got 2 3-packs of the other one, the middle one.
Mm-hmm.
The one that's up there in the picture, the S, from February 2011. So
yeah, really, really great smokes.
Probably my favorite, one of my favorite My Fathers.
Oh, I would say when
right
I first started smoking my when I first started smoking premium cigars, My Father was kind of coming on the scene then, you know. Actually, it wasn't really right when I first started, but before I started collecting hardcore, let's say that, right? So they were out, and I was smoking a lot of the Le Bijou Churchills.
I like the Le Bijou. I think
was smoking a lot of them. I went away from them for a little while. And I've recently gone back and smoked like 3 or 4 different My Fathers recently. And I still love them. I still love the Le Bijou.
So
I love the regulars.
One, I don't know what happened with my phone, or my son got on there and started deleting pictures or something. But I did smoke the My Father Cigars 15th Anniversary Atlantic Cigar special one. I bought a 5-pack of those. It was really good. I mean, it starts off with a blast of spice and pepper. It does settle down very quickly and presents this sweet flavor in the middle third. The final third, it really picked up in intensity and was a lot to handle in the final third. And I wasn't a huge fan, but that middle third was really, really super awesome.
Yeah.
So
I haven't smoked one of them, but I've heard really great things about them.
Yeah.
Well, I guess I could segue into my next one then. Which was, ironically enough, another My Father. It was a Federal cigar. It's a My Father Lee Bijou 1922 Ecuadorian wrapped My Father or Federal cigar house blend. Okay. It's,
yeah.
I smoked a Corona size, very typical Corona size, 46 by 5 5/8. It has instead of the traditional Le Bijou wrapper, it has the Connecticut Seed Ecuadorian wrapper. I thought it was easily box worthy, and I think they come in boxes of 23. I think all the My Fathers come in boxes of 23. It had what I've grown to actually like over the past couple months, that creamy Connecticut wrapper, or taste from the wrapper for that matter. But what I've been liking about some of the more recent iterations of Connecticut wrap cigars is they're putting them on more full bodied blends. Right. And this one is right there. It's it's a lot of really well-balanced spice and pepper, that you would expect from a pepin, but it has that nice, creaminess, added, you know, dimension added to it.
Yeah.
I really highly recommend you going to Federal Cigar and at least getting a 5-pack of these. These are really good, in my opinion, box worthy.
I find this a lot of the direct-to-retailer cigars are worth seeking out. A lot of them have been really good lately.
Oh, yeah. This is right up there, too. Mm. This is really, really good. They made a 91st anniversary for them. That was a Connecticut wrapped Le Bijou.
Yeah.
And then a regular Le Bijou wrapped. I think they call them Cervantes, I think, were what they were called. Mm-hmm. This is, they were so popular that they came out with this house blend that's going to be readily available all the time there. And I highly recommend it. You give them a call and they'll take care of you.
How's everyone's EP Carrillo core line and Ecantos doing?
Fantastically. Yeah.
I find that the flavors are very, very pronounced. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't have to work hard to recognize at least the very prominent flavors in the cigar. It's kind of got the flavor that really jumps out at me. I can't quite place exactly. Like I said, it's almost like a wood flavor that has been used as a storage container to store fruit.
Hmm. Yeah, it definitely has that toasty wood.
My description has been getting more and more exotic lately. I don't know what's wrong with me.
Go with maybe it, it's dude. My go with it, man.
That one's out there. I got pumpkin in the one last week, and now I've got fruit wood. Did I really just say I have fruit wood?
You okay. Did say you know have fruit wood.
I'm going on to my next cigar. Speaking of my wood, this one's a mini Corona from Asylum Cigars. And it's a like a 4x44, I want to say.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Inexpensive cigar.
Yeah, $5. Did you smoke some of these?
Yeah.
I didn't think they were that great. I mean, they weren't bad, but they weren't that great either.
Construction was an issue.
Yeah, my draw was kind of tight on mine.
And then at the very end, the cigar kind of turned a little sour. Like, the last third.
It did.
It's like, and then I just chuck it.
Yeah.
But, I mean, try it. For $5 a stick, what do you got to lose?
Yeah, that was my assessment, I believe, was would be try one on this one. Again, wasn't a big fan. There was nothing that really wowed me about it. There was nothing that was terribly balance, like it wasn't the most balanced cigar in the world, but it wasn't bad either. Yeah. It wasn't lawn mulch, certainly, but
it's spicy.
So this is a,
I would say it's spicy.
It's spicy, yeah. Yeah.
Christian Iroa's departure from Camacho, yeah. I believe,
this
right?
Is new,
thank you,
new company.
Yeah,
I was turned off immediately by the packaging. I don't know.
You don't
I,
like baby skulls?
No, I don't. I have a child. No, I'm not really super psyched about that. But
is that what it is? Baby skulls?
It looks like I don't a baby
know.
Skull.
It, yeah, it does kind of look like one to me. I was interested to see what was going to come from him because I thought the older Camacho stuff was really good when he had his hand in it, you know? The packaging turned me off, and then I did a little bit more research and he's making mostly gigantic size cigars.
Oh yeah.
Like, I think the other two sizes that I've seen of this are a huge, really tiny Corona and then a 6x60 and, believe it or not, a 7x70.
Yeah.
A 7x70.
But the 7x70, for people who like really big ring gauges, that's like $7 or like $8.
Yeah. If you like a 6x60, a 70x70 is awesome, right?
Yeah. Like that. No, that might.
I guess. If you're into that kind of thing.
Yeah, if you like big ring gauge cigars.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah.
That's just 70 by 70. It's just a monster stick.
Oh, God, it is. It's horrible.
It's horrible. I have nightmares about it. Halloween was yesterday, dude.
Oh, it was.
Today is November 1st, by the way.
I hope people that don't live in the Northeast were able to enjoy their Halloween. Mm. Our particular neighborhood was able to enjoy Halloween, but... some of us New Englanders and mid-Atlantic states were not so lucky. So, you know.
What was your Halloween cigar? I walked around and I followed my son and my wife and my dogs and our friends.
I saw your costume. That was a nice costume.
I was dressed up as a SWAT team member. The nice part about the SWAT team members, you get the vest, right? The vest can hold cigars in this upper pouch. I had like three cigars
where
in the
upper
pouch.
Where you put your shotgun shells.
Yeah. And then in the big holsters for, like, the big 30-round clips for your AR-15 is you can put beers. So I walked around and my vest was loaded with beer and cigars.
Well done.
Yeah.
Well done.
And I had the Ashton VSG, what I believe was a wizard. Okay. Pretty sure it was a wizard. And it was damn good.
Oh, that's
I tell you what, it was a perfect
blend.
Cigar. Burnt great. It poured flavor. It was. It had some age on it too, I think. But it was absolutely
pretty much the, whole,
the perfect cigar for walking around the neighborhood on a nice cool evening. It was awesome. Mm. Held up great. The end it got a little squishy, but I mean, when you're holding it, walking around, and all that stuff, you can't really fault a cigar for getting kind of weird at the
gunked
end.
Up, yeah. No, I didn't actually get to have a Halloween cigar. Believe it or not, I drove down to my mom's house and freed her. I cut, trees off of her house and things of that nature.
Not conducive to cigar smoking.
No, not at all. But, you know, it's what you got to do.
Got to do what you got to do. Did you have more on your list you want to talk about?
It is my turn now.
I'm holding a nice ash on this one. I got to hold it up for the camera. It's going to follow me any moment now.
So you guys are probably going to be, knowing Paul and I, are going to be a little surprised by this. I had an Opus that I was not happy with.
Really?
At all.
Get
and
out.
Poor construction.
Get out.
Yeah. Lost City Robusto.
That's a different take on the Opus X blend.
It is.
I find it to be very different from the Opus.
It is very, very different, and I've really, really enjoyed these Lost Cities.
I smoked the Lost City Torpedo at the end of the last show that was given to us for listener. Thank you again. I think it was Alex. Listener Alex gave that to us. That was awesome. And I'll tell you about my Opus X that I put on there.
So I smoked two Opuses this week. First time I've done that in a long time.
We had to make up for it. We didn't talk about Opus last week, really.
Yeah,
so
we
got to
do it.
We got to do it.
Yeah, if this was my first Opus X Lost City, I would say, right? But I've smoked enough that I know that they're really great. The draw was awful. It was really, really tight. I wasn't able to get any real discernible flavors from it. Really disappointing.
It sucks, dude.
Yeah.
It happens sometimes with rare occasions, but it.
With the thing is though is I look forward to lighting these up so often that when that happens, it really kind of disappoints me.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Bummer.
And speaking while we're on the lines of disappointments, I tried to smoke two Viaje honey and hand grenades. I had was almost like a Robusto size. So what was the deal with these? You guys have smoked these, right?
I've smoked the two shorter sizes.
Yeah, not the Rapier.
No, which I've heard is the best.
Really?
So this one was longer and skinnier. That's this one right here.
The Shiv, the Shank, and the
and
Rapier.
And the Rapier, exactly.
So this may be the Shiv and the Shank?
The Shank is the stoutest.
Yeah, that's the Shank right there. Yeah. Yeah.
And then the Shiv is the one right below it.
Yeah.
Because the Rapier is long. It's like a...
Oh, you know.
It's a long
I have one of those. I tried to smoke the two smaller sizes, and they just had... unbelievably awful construction problems of voids and being plugged all in the same.
I didn't.
It was horrible.
Yeah, I didn't have horrible. That. Luckily enough, I just thought that they were boring.
Okay.
So even when they're not poorly,
so the initial flavors I got off them, I'm like, well, this would probably be a pretty good cigar, but I couldn't really tell. But you're saying they don't really change up or have flavors that really?
Yeah, I do remember construction issues. That like you were saying, a lot of tunneling. I got some tunneling in mind.
I think that was my primary problem was tunneling. A lot of voids.
Mm.
I'm not sure why that happens in this particular blend.
I did think that the flavors were pretty decent. I got a spice, but also a sweetness off of it.
Right. Nice. Mark Jude and I both smoked the My Uzi Weighs a Ton bait fish. These came into the local shop. This comes in a, you can, it's kind of a bad picture up there, but you can sort of see the packaging. These pictures came, they look darker up on that screen. But the packaging, they come five in a, it looks like the way they package fish. Is that what it's meant to imitate? Like you get the fish and they wrap it in the paper?
Yeah, I guess so.
So they, it comes wrapped in a, in paper with clear tape holding it together. And there are five to a pack and there were $29.95 in my local shop. So I figured, hey, why not? I liked it when they first came out. And this is not the same cigar as
when they first came out. Was that the first? Was that a pre-release or is that?
That was a direct-to-store release to New Havana Cigars.
Exactly. Yeah.
And those were awesome. I really liked those.
Everyone raved about.
So they re-released them, and it's thumbs down. I didn't like it at all.
Worse than thumbs down.
I thought it was. I give it lawn mulch, dude.
Yeah, I was pissed. I smoked it. Mm-hmm. I was even more pissed that I had four left.
Unbalanced, harsh, tight draw. Just didn't care for this one. Nothing like the original release is what I wrote in my notes.
I didn't. I was so excited for these to come out because I didn't get a chance to smoke the original ones.
So act and now. You can get eight My Uzi Weighs a Ton bait fish at a really great price.
After this ringing endorsement.
Yeah. So we're in at lawn mulch, so maybe we'll run a contest. Whoever loses the contest, we're going to send eight. You have to smoke all eight.
You have to be the worst.
You have to be the worst. And then whatever contest we come up with next, and we'll send you these. Yeah, they were bad.
World's worst contest.
It was harsh, though, huh?
It was harsh.
Wow. It was harsh. It was sour. It burnt, like, horribly. And I thought, yeah, I just was thoroughly disappointed by it completely. Yeah.
I had to say, out of all the releases coming out of Drew Estate recently, I haven't been all that impressed. I like the, I'll talk about the ones I like. I like the L40, right?
Yep. L40's awesome.
L40s are awesome. The Radzilla didn't really impress me.
Still haven't smoked mine because of what everyone said. So yeah. I'm waiting to smoke it.
This new baitfish, not a big fan. Even with a lot of my older Liga Privada number 9s, I've noticed a lot of construction problems with them. I can pick them up and almost feel a void within them. I smoked that super old one, and the flavors weren't all that great. So,
yeah.
You smoked a T52 Robusto, though.
I did. We'll make that one next on my list. I smoked the T52.
You looked totally engaged in that cigar.
Yeah, no. I
was kind of jealous. I was kind of like, well, I wish I had some aged T52 Robustos because that looks really fucking good.
Yeah, it was gifted to me by a brother from Cigar Pass, Joe Bunga. Thank you very much if you're listening. Well done, Paul. You weren't the first, though. I'm going to admit I did it earlier.
That was a big ash, too. There's a lot of ash on me now. We may need to consult my ash removal tools just for those. This little can of air. Sorry, Ben.
Sorry.
Okay.
So, I have no idea how much age was on this, but as a matter of fact, I still have the band. The band was quite yellowed. And it was tremendous. Thank you, Joe, if you're listening. I hope you are. It started off with this ridiculous chocolate blast that
you said that you were like, oh my god, this is so chocolatey.
Yeah, right from the get-go too. And it was,
and then like 2 minutes later, oh my god, this is still so chocolatey.
Yeah, it was so good. It was,
and I'm like, dude, you got any more of those?
Yeah, no, and it's a funny story too. I got it because I was saying how I thought the newer nines that have been coming out were just not that good. Mm. I don't know what happened to them. I just didn't think they were that good. And he's like, well, try one of these. And, you know, of course, I'd tried T52s before. But who's to look a gift horse in the mouth, right? So I took it, and I finally got around to smoking it. And, damn, that thing was great. And if the blend hasn't changed, that is a box-worthy cigar, in my opinion. Buy those, age them, and enjoy the chocolate candy bar that you're going to have when you finally smoke it.
Yeah, I've got, let's see. I bought a box of Liga Privada number 9 Bellicosos in March of 2009.
Mm.
And I still have some left. So maybe I'll go round those up and we can smoke those and see what they're all about.
I'll help you with that.
Yeah, I need some help with that. Can anyone help me out with that? I did a redo really quick, the EP Carrillo inaugural 2009. I know I talked a lot about these on the show, but I just have to say, like, I feel like they're aging out. So
hurry
I've
up.
Been smoking them and enjoying them a lot. And I think that once you find the sweet spot in an aged cigar, that's definitely what you want to do. It's just go back and smoke them. You know what I mean? And they're just like with coffee in the morning. It's a really, really mild, mellow cigar. Just when I went to the shooting range with our mutual friend, I gave him one of those. It's kind of a thank you for, you know, inviting me as his guest. And I tell you, first thing in the morning, in just a crisp morning air, it was so good. It was so good. Surprisingly held up pretty well, too, of like, you know, resting on the table and putting down, doing other stuff while I was smoking it. And fortunately, my shooting partner had put it a little too close to his rifle, and the rifle blast at one point blew off the wrapper to the cigar. So, tip when shooting it, make sure you put it behind you or something, away from the muzzle blast. Because the wrapper is kind of thin on these.
Yeah.
The ones we smoked, it held up pretty well.
Unique, too, for an EPC blend. They're not very spicy. They're definitely not, like, strong at all. They're, like, maybe on the lighter side of medium in terms of strength. But in terms of flavor, they're full-flavored, without a doubt.
Yeah.
Tons of sweetness. I love them.
Yes.
Love them.
So those are definitely box-worthy.
Yep.
Now, what about you, Mark? Did you have more on your...
Yeah, I've got...
Go ahead.
Two more, I think. Yeah, two more. Okay. I smoked a Opus X, my second Opus X, Robusto, 5.25x50. I'd love to tell you what the blend is, but they don't tell you what the blend is.
It's the Opus X blend.
It's the Opus X blend. This thing had a dusting of plume over the entire cigar, Paul. I showed it to you when
I think you just smoked this one, yeah.
This was Oasis, in my opinion. It was so well balanced.
Now, what size was it? It looked like a large Robusto.
Yeah, it was a 5.25x52.
Okay.
Yeah. It was so well balanced. It had the sweetness. It had the leather. It had the, you know, typical Opus flavors that we all rant and rave about. You don't need me to rant and rave about those again. But there was none of the nicotine strength in it, so it really allowed me to truly enjoy these flavors despite the fact that I had a cold and felt like I wasn't enjoying them as much as I could, and still was blown away by this cigar.
It seemed like it had hit the peak. Now, what year did you say this was?
05.
Okay. It seemed like it had definitely peaked.
Yeah, I think that's the sweet spot right there.
It's interesting.
Yeah, no, they're phenomenal.
And that's
phenomenal.
Seven years?
7 years.
Wow. That's pretty good.
Yeah, I have a bunch more of them, too.
Really?
Yeah.
Maybe we need to trade.
Okay.
we need to trade on some of those, for sure.
First, as a matter of fact, I'll give one of them to a listener, too.
Well, there you go.
Yeah.
We have another contest.
Yeah. By the end of the show, we'll think of something, and I'll send one out to a listener.
We'll make you listen to...
Give us the most disturbing picture you can find on the internet.
No! That is not the contest.
Best Halloween costume. Everyone send in their Halloween costume. I'll judge them.
Yeah, but what if you... But this is going to come out way after Halloween, though.
What are you talking about?
Like, by the time the show airs, though...
Oh, true.
You know?
Okay.
It may be Monday. All
right, we'll still think.
Yeah. We're going to make people listen to the whole show.
Okay.
So if you want an Opus X from 2005...
You're going to have to hang in there.
You're going to have to hang in there. At the end of the show, we'll come up with a contest for you.
Cool.
And then you can send an email to stogiegeeks@gmail.com. Don't send it now, because we haven't given you the contest yet. So.
Okay.
I, too, smoked an Opus X. I wish this one had aged a lot more, actually. By all estimation, I would say this was around 2009, 2010 time frame. What size would you say that was, Mark Jr.?
Well, it's hard to say.
It's got cedar on it.
The two that come that way are either the Robusto
or
the double Robusto.
This was probably a double Robusto. A Perfection X? No.
Nope. Different cigars. Double Robusto.
Double Robusto.
Yep.
Yeah, it was... it would fit that description. Yeah. It was a lot larger than a Robusto.
Like a 56, so. Probably, if you had to guess? I think they're 54s. 54.
It was probably closer to 54, I would say.
Yeah.
Because the 56, I know, is the other size that I really like. And I know that ring gauge. This was probably 54. Probably 5.5 or 6 by 54, almost. It was really good. It was really good. But
that's another one of the great Vitolas.
It really did kick me in the teeth, though, like strength-wise.
Nicotine strength, right?
Nicotine strength was... Yeah, for something being a few years old, and this is car, again, is at least 2 years old, kicked me in the teeth strength-wise. However, I hung in there because of what I describe as nice leather flavors. I definitely got the leather. But I got what I call an awesome sauce style sweetness. That's my
awesome.
That's my term for the sweetness that presents itself in Opus X. It's an awesome sauce style sweetness that just keeps bringing me back for more. Now, a lot of people will debate between the... And I had to put Opus on here this week because I didn't smoke an Opus last week. So I felt I needed to make up for it.
Sure.
And smoke one this week.
You felt guilty, like you were cheating.
I felt like, I was cheating. But, you know, I did smoke an Añejo. I don't know if I can bring that up there so you guys can see it. I can. So what size do you think that is? It's like a...
That's a 50 or a 46.
A Robusto? No, the ring gauge was small.
No, that's too long. That's a 46.
Yeah.
That's a 46.
A 46. And this was good. I tell you what, though. The flavors... In the Opus X, to me, really jump out, and I can identify with more easily than the Añejo. I just don't find it has the depth of flavor and as strong of flavors as the Opus blend. And therefore, that's why I enjoy smoking Opus. Now, a lot of people say, wow, forget Opus. Añejo is way better, and it's cheaper, and it's more available, and it's just better all around, and it's not as strong. I don't agree. I like... In large part, I would choose Opus X over Añejo, with the exception of the Shark.
So, oddly, you should say that, right? That is my favorite Añejo size.
Really?
Yeah.
At least a year old, too.
I think the flavors in a Shark get lost on me a little bit because so much smoke comes out of it.
It is a large ring gauge, too.
It is a ton of smoke.
But I'm able to get a lot of flavor out of the Añejos.
Yeah, but they do have a very distinct chocolate and coffee-type chocolate flavor.
Am I crazy or is like the Añejo Shark flavors so much different than a lot of the other Añejo?
They are, completely. Yeah,
completely
The smaller ones tend to have like a barnyardy taste and smell to them that is not in the Shark. Which is, I think, why I kind of like the smaller blends. I really am a huge fan of the 50s and 46s.
I just found a whole box of Añejo Sharks from last year.
You found it?
December. Mm. It was in my humidor.
Oh.
On the bottom.
Oh.
Like, buried in it, like, all the other boxes, like, almost so I couldn't see it. Like, I think I purposely, like, tried to hide it on myself.
Yeah.
And I'm like, there's no way that this box is full. Oh, it was full. Mm. Completely full. I'm like, whoa. Nice. So I've been trying to work my way through the ones that are 2 years old. The ones that are 2 years old are just, I probably have 5 or 6 of those left. They're just awesome. You smoked one that was really old, too, a while back, I remember.
Yes, I did. Yeah, that was a few months ago now, wasn't it?
And
yeah.
You thought that was...
Don't get me wrong. I am not saying I don't like the Shark. I really like the Sharks. I really like the whole blend, to be honest with you. I like all the sizes. The 48s and... Or what are they... Yeah, 48s and 49s, the Churchills and the Toro sizes. Those are great, too. I really like them all. 55 is the Bellicoso size. It's a great smoke, too. I dig them.
Cool.
They age extremely well, too.
They do. They definitely age very, very well. Let's see. So I put this Opus as box-worthy. I'd put the Añejo Shark as Oasis for me, for sure. The next one on my list was a Babyface from the Little Monsters collection. These are just so, so tasty.
Yeah,
I
agree.
I think they're maybe my favorite Little Monster. I don't know. They're really, really good.
That I will disagree with, but I do
you
like
think
the
little. What do you think, the Little Drac or the Little Frank?
Is it Frank Jr.?
Frank Jr.
Yeah.
Frank Jr.
Can't get enough of those.
Really?
Can't get enough of them.
I need to go back and smoke one of those. Because I smoked a Little Drac and I smoked a Babyface recently. I'll go back and.
And the mini mum's great too. Those four: the mini mum, the Frank, the Drac, and the Babyface. Love them all.
So the only one that's left is the Wolfie, which the larger blend of the Wolfman.
I think it's better than the bigger one. But yeah. I think the blend was just off. I don't think it was a good blend.
I think you're right. Yeah, I'd look to unload all my Wolfman and.
I did. Wolfies. Actually, I got rid of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If anyone's interested, contact me, stogiegeeks@gmail.com. I'm more than willing to make a direct sale to anyone who emails.
Yeah.
I will take an inventory. I've got I've only smoked one Wolfman, maybe two, out of my box.
I kept trying to give it a chance. Yeah. I really did. I kept trying to give it a chance.
I have a full dress box. Like, the actual box is a dress box, and I've probably smoked, there's probably 11 sticks left in there. And I've got three boxes of Little Monsters with the Wolfies, Little Wolfies in there. And there may not be too many missing from those. So there might be five or six.
Yeah.
I'd definitely be willing to unload all those. For sure. But don't care for them.
No, I agree. But every other one of them in there, if they came out with a box of 10 of every other one of them, I would buy a box of 10 each.
Yeah.
Without even hesitating.
And it's funny, I mean, this the baby face has a lot of the same flavors as the face, more concentrated, but you get that sweet caramel.
Yeah.
I think it's sweet caramel you get from the face blends, which is very different from all the other Little Monsters.
They're actually all very different, to be honest. All of them
are
all
completely different blends, yeah. I agree. Yeah.
I have
almost no similarities between them.
Yeah, no, yeah. I completely agree with that assessment. In terms of the... I think two points here, the first of which is that it's interesting and should be noted that I think the mini mum and the mummy have two completely different flavor profiles. Did you notice that at all, Paul?
What was that? Sorry, I'm responding to people in the chat room.
The mini mum and the mummy have two very different flavor profiles.
I don't know. I have to go back and smoke them.
I found the mummy, the full-size mummy, to be very creamy and not very strong. Where the minimum had a nice little strength to it that I thought was very good. I like both of them. Now, in terms of the large ones, I've the Drac, actually, I've actually recently acquired two of them, and I smoked one of them, is such an awesome smoke. At the end, it kind of falls apart, but that is a very dynamic smoke.
It's got the most change-ups. It does.
A lot. And
subtle changes too.
Yeah, and I think that was a pretty masterful cigar, to be honest with you.
How's everyone's EP Carrillo doing?
Awesome. I'm reveling in it right now.
It's really good, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, for regular production, what did we say these costs? Hold on. You know what? I had a review pulled up on these. I want to say they're... Hold on. Toastedfoot.com. I'll give them props because they've got a review of the exact cigar that we're smoking. EP Carrillo Core Line, Ecantos 4 7/8 by 50. A box of 20 is $15.95. So you can do the math. They gave it a total of a 9.3 on their rating system, calling it a solid offering from EP Carrillo and family. Medium bodied in flavor, the finish is solid, and put it on his top 10 list for 2010.
Fair enough.
So
one thing I could say about this is that it's lost that spice that was prevalent in the beginning, but it's kind of gotten a little sweeter, which is nice. Introduced a little bit of a different sweet note to it too, not necessarily that fruity sweetness that we were both getting in the
beginning. I'd say, and I'm approaching the final third, I'd say it's definitely picked up in intensity. It's got a lot more oomph to it for me than it did in the first third. It kind of starts out almost a little mellow, you know? It's got a little punch to it, but it starts off kind of mellow, and then it continues to pick up in intensity.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Very, very good smoke.
Yeah. Which you want a cigar to do, I think, is it?
Yeah. Yeah,
you want the intensity of that. So, I don't know. For some reason, like, looking at it and people calling it medium body, I expect it to be not as full strength as it is. Mm. But people do say the strength is medium full, which means they age really well, too.
And, yes, absolutely.
I think we're definitely experiencing the benefits of that. So... With that, we'll take a short break and come back, and we're going to talk about Coolidors. Off the cuff, we're all going to talk about Coolidors. Benefits, how to do it, style of coolers.
We're also going to open the window in here.
Yes, sorry. I meant to do that before the show started. So with that, we'll take a short break for ventilation and come back and talk about Coolidors.